ever wondered what it's really like to self-publish? Obsessive, compulsive, addictive. Autonomy, power, freedom, control. Accountability, responsibility, a heavy burden. These are just a few of the feelings that self-published authors have every single day. In this podcast, we'll explore the everyday of being a self-published author, with a focus on process over outcomes. If we do the small things really well every single day and consistently, then the outcomes will take care of itself. Here is what it's like. Welcome to the diary of a self-published author. Hello and welcome to the diary of a self-published author with me, Stuart White. Today's day is Wednesday the 21st of June. I'm recording on a Wednesday evening, unusually. I usually try and do this on a Thursday evening, but tomorrow is the last day of term for my school up here in Scotland. I know that's different from other parts of the world. And so we're going out for a little lunch after prize giving, probably a couple of drinks as well. So I thought I would record tonight just so I didn't have to do that when I get in tomorrow night. So yeah, exciting times in terms of it being the end of term as well, because obviously for me as a teacher, teaching consumes a lot of my week. So I get more time-ish to spend on my writing and my publishing career. So it's nice that the end of term is around the corner for me. And I know that for English schools, for example, it's just a couple of weeks away, and around the world, I think in the US they've already stopped, haven't they, for summer. So it's a nice time of year for us writers. We should get a little bit more time, although if you're like me and you've got a couple of kids, then the summer holidays doesn't always equate to loads of extra free time. But there certainly will be little pockets here and there that I can use to good effect, I hope. So that's enough about my weekly goings on. First of all, we're going to chat a little bit about some general news from the self-publishing sphere, as we always do. And something that I read a little bit about this week and is quite a notable thing that is being discussed within the community is about the use of AI for audiobook narration. Now, it's not a new discussion. This has been a discussion for a number of months now. I remember listening to a Joanna Penn podcast episode a while ago. It was probably last year even, talking about this very thing. And I think she said that she was going to experiment with it and see how it went. And in her opinion, it didn't sound too bad at all when she went ahead and did it and so on. But I guess the discussion needs to be had around not just the practicalities of it, i.e. can you do it and does it sound good, but also, I guess, the ethics of it. And for those who are audiobook narrators, for example, and that's one of their primary sources of income, is doing that job, are we in danger of losing some good people because there isn't enough work for them? Because obviously people in more limited budgets are maybe going AI rather than human. And secondly, in terms of the quality of the product as well, do we, and the answer's clear to me, but do we lose out on a lot of the soul and the finesse and the little touches that we get with a human narrating a book as opposed to AI? You can't necessarily give AI instructions. Of course you can give it instructions, but you can't give it like specific instructions or anything too detailed or nuanced. You know, you don't get the nuances, I don't think, with AI. And so you'd get something that's maybe good quality, but it might be quite bland to listen to, I think, throughout. Whereas with a human narrator, you get that feeling, you get that emotion in their voice as well as they're reading it. If they're reading a scene that's exciting, you probably get that in their voice. Or if they read a scene that's really sad or upsetting, you probably get that in their voice as well. Joy, happiness too. I mean, all these things, I think they come through in the spoken word and with our voices. And so I think it's definitely something that we have got to be looking to strive to maintain. And I know that there's been a lot of discussion about contracts and legalities about declaration of the use of AI, even if there isn't any anything, you know, anything that gets in your way from actually using the AI to narrate your book. So that will be interesting to monitor and to see how that goes over the next, you know, year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, and see if, and I hope it doesn't go this way, but to see if more and more people start to use that as a way to cut back, obviously, in spending. And also just quickness as well. I think a lot of time is spent in a human actually sitting down and reading the audiobook and having to obviously do retakes and so on of different scenes to reread certain sections. And then obviously the editing that comes after that too. All of that is extremely time consuming as well as expensive. So the use of AI may well increase over time because it might be seen as a cost effective and time saving method to do it. But anyway, I thought that was quite an interesting one. I was reading about it in the Hot Sheet. That's the Jane Friedman one that I always talk about, which comes out fortnightly, I think, and the latest edition came out today. There's lots of other interesting things in there as well. We're talking about, and this is something that self-published authors obviously are really on top of, but they were talking about how when publishers and authors collaborate more about sharing data on customers and people that have shown interest in the book and all of these kind of things, how that can really benefit obviously both parties. And to me, that just makes sense, you know, like that everyone involved in the process should have access to all of the data. And I genuinely think it's crazy that publishers, traditional publishers, don't provide their authors with all of the data that they have on sales. And then, and in some ways that then worries me, and I think, well, why don't they do that? As you know, like, it just doesn't make any sense, because the authors are doing more and more and more, even traditionally published authors are doing more and more and more of their own marketing work these days. So, you know, surely a joint effort there would make more sense. I guess there's probably a reason for it, maybe a time issue or whatever, in terms of, you know, downloading reports, sending them on to authors, etc. But I just find it crazy that, you know, these discussions have been had now as if it's like a revolutionary new thing that that people should be. And I'm like, well, this is obvious. This should have been something that's been happening for a long time. It's like the crazy thing that they get their royalty statement every 6 months, and that's it. Like, so they sit for 6 months in the dark, no idea how things are going. And to me, that's crazy when you've got so many automated systems that are regularly updating book sales. Like, there's no reason that an author can't have access to that particular thing. You know, if it's Nielsen scan, or the scanning book database thing, where, you know, every time there's a sale of a book, then it gets updated there and so on. Like, there's no reason why authors couldn't have that for their own book. I don't think anyway, but there's obviously a reason that they don't. And all of this stuff, anyway, it just makes sense to me that you'd work in collaboration with your publisher. But anyway, that was an interesting read in the Hot Sheet as well. So, you know, even if you're more of a traditionally published author rather than a self-published author, then there's still some good stuff in that particular edition for you to have a read at. But anyway, well, let's move on from the general news from the self-publishing sphere. And I'm delighted to be able to share with you some really good news on a personal level. The last time I spoke, I think I mentioned that I'd been shortlisted for an award. That's the Book Awards, the Bookshop Awards with Right Blend Bookshop in Liverpool, run by Bob, who contacted me last month and said that my book had been shortlisted for their category award. And I was obviously delighted about that, and very happy just to be considered, very honoured. But I'd very sensibly not got my hopes up too high and had sort of, you know, planned around not winning and so on. So when I got the email on Saturday morning, about 2 hours before it was announced by them on social media, I didn't actually open it until it was, you know, half an hour after they said they were going to send it, because I just didn't expect it. I wasn't sitting there waiting, refresh, as we sometimes do at 9 o'clock. And so, you know, like, and it felt like it was nice. It's amazing. I'm astonished that I won, and I'm delighted and everything. But it was interesting to, and I think this comes from being a self-published author now as well, it was interesting not to have built up so much hope about something, and then obviously had the crushing disappointment if it doesn't go well. But also when it does go well, then because you've built up so much hope, sometimes the reality doesn't meet the expectation in terms of your hopes. Sometimes it does, but then, you know, it's just, you're just matching your expectations. So, you know, it's maybe not the same buzz there as there is when you take my approach of just, you know, thinking, well, I'll probably not want it. And so when you do, it's a huge uplift in terms of your mood and your confidence and your self-esteem and everything else that comes with having external affirmation of your abilities as a writer, which is obviously what this, winning this award has done for me. And, you know, Bob said a very kind thing in his social media where he said that he definitely believes that the book deserves a wider exposure and a wider audience. And it's, you know, it's as good as any of the other middle grade books that he's got in the shop, that, you know, that I've got much bigger reach and so on. And so that's, you know, for me personally as a writer, that's the best praise. You know, as a self-published author, that's the best praise you can get, is to be told that your book sits well alongside those other books that have been acquired by publishers. So anyway, that's been a particular high this week, and I've really enjoyed it. I got this lovely trophy, which I shared on my social media. If you're listening to the podcast, you can just go to my social media and see it. But if you're watching me on YouTube, you can have a look at the video just now, and I'm just holding up the beautifully designed trophy award. It's funny because I picked it up, and it's not too heavy, actually. It's quite light, and so I don't know why I'm just struggling with the concept of the weight of it. And I dropped it earlier on. I was worried I would break it, but it all seems quite sturdy and well produced. So yeah, it's nice to have something like that. That It's a nice extra touch, and I should say that the whole awards and the way they've been run and the way they've treated me, and obviously the trophy and the package they sent the trophy and stuff, and it's just lots of little nice touches about it, and it feels very personal and meaningful, and you know, and that's nice. It's nice to feel like that as well. So anyway, I won the award, and that's lovely. I think I posted this in my socials as well, but there was a nice touch from Bob. He wrote my name and address on the package, but he also wrote award-winning author above my name, and that gave me obviously a bit of a buzz, and made me feel really, really positive about myself in terms of, and this is something I've talked about before, is about how identity is a result of repeated affirmations to yourself about what you do and who you are. And sometimes that obviously comes from yourself, but often it needs to be instigated by other people, you know. So people say, oh, you're so good at, and then you go, oh yeah, well actually I'm quite good at that, and then you go on and that becomes part of your identity, you know. And I think that him saying award-winning author and stuff on the that's just all playing into a really positive identity for me in terms of feeling like I'm an author at all times, which is something that doesn't always register. And I think because I'm self-published too, there's a great deal of imposter syndrome a lot of the time. You can feel a bit like a fraud, like, you know, I've just published my book, so where's the quality assurance in that, and so on. So yeah, anyway, it's been lovely to get that confidence booster, and to feel good about that. And I guess I've had a couple of second places, short listings, long listings, and so on, with books in unpublished author competitions. So it was, yeah, it was bizarre to get my first win as a published author, you know, as opposed to before. But I guess that's probably actually more normal than the other way around, if you think about it. So yeah, anyway, it's been nice, and I'll stop going on about it now. But I've really enjoyed this last week or so, taking all that in. And obviously, thanks as well if you're listening and you're one of the many people who passed on your congratulations. It really is nice, and it means a lot when I get so much support for these things as well, because again, it helps to build towards that identity as someone who can actually do this thing and become an author, even though I'm forging my own path to do it, as opposed to going down a more well-trodden one. So anyway, there we go. That was my big writing news for the week. The other thing I was going to discuss as well on this episode was something I promised you last week, which was to talk about the campaign I'm doing this week. So I started a Kindle countdown deal on Monday morning. It was that it started, and it's running through till Friday. So for another day or two after this podcast is released, I've gone down to 99 cents on the Amazon.com marketplace, the US marketplace, or predominantly US marketplace. It does cover actually a lot of the world. And I have also put in a few little marketing boosts as well, like reader lists, mailer lists and stuff with various companies, likes of Written Word Media that I've talked about before. The Fussy Librarian as well. That was another one that I tried out this time for the first time. So it'll be interesting to see at the end of the week what the results are from that that little push that we got as well. We also did one with, I've forgotten the name now. Bargain Booksy, which is with the Written Word Media. Good Kindles as well, which is good, and we'll see how that one works out in terms of the numbers. But this is funny. You get a little bar chart on your KDP dashboard for your sales, and you know, it's quite good to give you wee graphs and stuff that tells you like where in the world people have bought the book from, what format they bought them in, whether it's paperback or Kindle, or if they've done Kindle Unlimited page reads as well. That shows all that stuff on there, which is quite good and insightful for you. But yeah, it's funny because the bar graph has been quite low and still steady sales, but not spectacularly high. And then Monday, and it was interesting because on Monday itself, because there's usually a wee bit of a delay in the reporting by a few hours, or sometimes even a day later. And I was thinking, oh, it's not actually going that well today for, you know, the money I've spent on the marketing and stuff. But then I got up on Tuesday and I checked the dashboard for the previous day, and there was a whole bunch of extra sales on there, which I hadn't seen the night before. So it feels like at the moment I'm probably in the break-even territory. I'll need to sit and work out all the sums at the end of the week. But that's good. I mean, that's what I'm wanting at this stage. I've talked about this before, but traditionally your first book wouldn't make any money. You'd make a loss on it. Your second book is where you're looking to break even, and by your third book, maybe to make a small profit on things. So the fact that I'm just breaking even and so on is fine with me. I'm not fussed about making a profit at this stage with this book. And again, I talk again along about the long game rather than the short game. And ultimately, I know that the sales that I make on Ghosts of Mars, my first book that I've self-published, those will continue now for however many years, you know, into the future, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, as long as self-publishing still exists and we have the platforms to do it, it'll continue to sell for all those years. And so I might not make a profit this year or next year or 5 years, but at some point down the line, the money that I've spent on the book will be surely eclipsed by the money that comes in. And so I'm not too worried about making the money back immediately. Which brings me on nicely actually to another point that I've discussed recently, which is the possibility of doing a Kickstarter for my YA novel that I'm planning to bring out later this summer. And I finally came last week to the decision that I'm not going to do that. And I'll talk about the reasons why. I did a social media post and a poll just to ask people what they thought about the idea of a Kickstarter as opposed to a normal publication launch for the book and so on. One of the points that a lot of people made was that it went reasonably well for me last time with Ghosts of Mars, and it did. I'm very happy with how everything's gone with it. There's no issues there. But I suspect, it'll go as well, maybe even better with the next one, the YA one. But the reason I was really keen on the Kickstarter is because I like to do different things. I like to see how we can do the same things but have different paths, different routes, different ways of doing it, especially because I'm really interested in the, because I'm fortunate enough and privileged enough to be able to afford the money to get a good cover artist and editor for my books that I'm self-publishing, but obviously not everyone is. And so I'm interested in making ways that, or trying out ways where people can do it for free so I can share that knowledge with people and help inform others to get their work out there and start making money on their books. But yeah, ultimately I've decided against it because I don't think it's just right at this time and for this book. But it's something I'm going to keep in the back burner and maybe come back to it at some point down the line and see. So yeah, we'll come back to it, and it'll be something I'll try out. And if you're interested in that kind of thing, I'll experiment and let you know how it goes with that. So yeah, so we've talked a little bit about the obviously the competition win, about the marketing campaign I did with the Kindle Countdown deal, the Kickstarter as well, which I'm probably going to leave aside now, which brings me on nicely again to what I am going to do with that YA novel. Now, I've seen the final cover, which is really, really exciting. Both the ebook cover and the paperback and the hardback cover. Now, that's something I'll mention just now is that I've decided to do hardback on the YA, which is something I decided not to do with Ghosts of Mars for a couple of reasons, but mostly to do with the trim size and stuff of hardbacks. But it's boring stuff. I won't go into all the minutiae of it. But for the Nameless, which is my YA that I'm bringing out later in the summer, and I've decided on a date for that, by the way. I think I'm going to go 30th of August. I've put that down anyway on the KDP dashboard. So, and you get a leeway of about a month. So, let's say we get closer to the time, and I'm not quite ready yet. I can delay it for up to a month. But I think you can only do that once without penalty, and then if you do delay it again, then you get a ticking off from Amazon, so it's not something you want to be doing lightly. But I think it'll be finished by the end of August, so I will be ready to go. And anyway, I've put down the date for that. But talking about the hardback, I decided I wanted to go for that because I think they do sell better at YA than they do middle grade, and also because 60% of people that buy YA are adults, and adults are more likely to have the disposable income to buy something that's a little bit more expensive and so on. And better quality, so I've decided to go for that anyway. And a good thing about print and demand is if they don't sell, they don't sell, and it's not the end of the world, in terms of money or anything else really. So yeah, I've given that a go, and we'll see how it works out in terms of the hardback thing. But one thing I should actually say in case people are interested in doing this is I decided to make the paperback and hardback trim sizes the same, and there was a specific reason for that. In terms of the, in terms of production of the covers and so on, I went with 6x9, which is quite a standard novel size. It's a wee bit bigger than what I did with Ghosts of Mars in terms of trim size, but it's a bigger book and it's YA, so I thought that was probably okay and it'll look good and so on. So I'm quite excited about it. Multiple formats and so on. And then just to, I guess, to bring it full circle back to where we started off the episode, to talk a little bit about audiobooks again. Now, this is something I've been considering a lot for my own work, is whether I should get an audiobook format for Ghosts of Mars, first of all, and then maybe for, you know, subsequent books as I bring them out. And I think it's something that I might look at towards the end of this year, is bringing out an audiobook version, because obviously there's huge growth in audiobook sales. Last year, the sales percentage increase was huge, whereas it was nowhere near as large in any other format. In fact, there was a couple of declines as well in terms of format. So, and I think part of that was due to the pandemic buying boom, and then just things returning back down to normal levels, as opposed to things declining too much overall, you know, with the overall long-term picture. So anyway, audiobooks is something that I think I am probably going to try and pursue towards the end of this year. And, you know, as I said earlier on, I've stated my position with that, which is that I'd want a human to narrate it. I have been looking at, so again, I like trying things out, and this is the reason I've been looking at it. So, you know, I probably could find the money to pay someone to do it, to get it edited and so on and uploaded for the audiobook. But I've been also looking at the possibility of, and some people do this, is they do their audiobook narration themselves, and they simply do it on YouTube or another platform like that, and they give the audiobook away for free, which was an interesting thing. I mean, I'm not sure I'll do that, to be perfectly honest, but it was an interesting thing to look into and, you know, have as a possibility and so on, is maybe doing audiobooks on YouTube or any, you know, different platforms where you can upload video and audio content, and just maybe doing it that way as well. I don't know, it's one of those things where I like the thought of playing around and doing something different, but I'll probably end up just going with the traditional human narrator, get it edited, upload it to all the or to Audible. There's a few issues as well. I won't go into it today, but there's a few issues as well with audiobooks in terms of, like, I don't know if it exists anymore, but there was an exclusivity thing and a lower royalty rate if you went wide beyond Amazon and so on. But anyway, that's something, that's a bridge for me to cross in a few months' time, and I'll obviously update you as I'm literally going over those bridges, so I can give you more insight than I can do right now. But that's something else to consider if you are going to go down that route too. All right, so that's the bulk of the book stuff done for this particular episode. In terms of the health side of things, now obviously I've had a lot of things go right this week since I last spoke to you, so mental health wise I have been pretty good. I had a couple of wobbles in terms of the editing of my YA novel in the last few days. It's just, you know, your typical stuff, like I'm looking at big picture things and I'm thinking, oh, actually I need to work on these like four or five chapters as a collective. I need to like stream them a bit, increase the pace, and that can seem a bit overwhelming when it's a big job like that. So I guess the key with any job is the job that's hardest through is the one that started last, and so I should probably swallow the toad. I can't remember the expression, but it's the one where you know you just get the worst task out of the way, and I should probably do that when after school finishes tomorrow. Do that as one of my first holiday priorities, to get it done, and then you know, mentally that'll be something else out in my head, and I'll feel a bit better afterwards, I think. And that's a good thing to consider, you know, for all writers at any stage, whether you're published or not, is when it comes to difficult aspects of writing, whether it's editing or the actual drafting itself, sometimes you just got to swallow the frog. And I know I'm saying that phrase wrong. I feel like I'm definitely saying it wrong, so you can correct me in the comments if I'm. But I hope that that's a good bit of advice for most people as well, if they're finding things difficult and not able to work their way through something. Just get it done, get it over with, and then, you know, you can always go back and do a better job and do it again if it's not a good enough job the first time. But if you let it just sit there and fester in your head, it sits in there and it's not good for you mentally. I think we all know that, so it's good to just clear that out and get it done as soon as we can. All right, so yeah, quite a positive episode, I would say, this week. I've quite enjoyed chatting about some of the stuff that I've had going on, and I hope that for those of you who listen, it's interesting to you and it might help you with your own self-publishing journey, wherever you're at, whether you've already published books or whether you're just considering it or you're in the process of doing it. As always, you can join my Facebook group, the private Facebook group for The Diary of a Self-Published Author, so you can just search for that and request to join, and I'll add you as long as a name or profile I recognise and doesn't seem dodgy in any way. And yeah, come along, there's a few of us in there now, and it'd be nice to chat a bit more and to answer a few more questions about self-publishing. And obviously, if you enjoy listening to the podcast, like, one thing I'd really love at the moment is for more people to share it and to tell other people about it that might be interested. If you can do that, if you can leave a rating on the podcast platforms as well, where you maybe listen to me, or you know, the old thumbs up and subscribe on YouTube if you watch the show from there. However you can support what I'm doing with the show and so on, obviously that's going to be a major help, and it'll be helpful in terms of trying to grow it and to help more and more people with it. I'm conscious that I've said a few times now I'm going to try and get some self-published author guests on as well to have a bit of a chat, so that's something with the summer holidays looming that I might have some time to do, and hopefully have some fun episodes coming up. But you know, in the meantime, hopefully what I'm contributing is of interest to you, and just let me know if there's anything you'd like me to discuss or cover that I don't regularly that you think would be a good little addition to the show. Just get in touch with me and you can let me know about that. All right, so I think that's enough for this week, and I'll speak to you all next week on The Diary of a Self-Published Author. Take care now, folks. Bye.